From the garage sale. So for the first time ever, we are allowing our members who are present to do some last minute shopping. And then after that, some last minute packing up the boxes so the Volunteers of America can take those boxes away on Tuesday. So if you have about 23 to 27 minutes after worship, there will be coffee, and you can pack up a couple of boxes. We have lots of boxes and lots of stuff. No one will be empty-handed. We would really, really appreciate your help. So many hands make light work. Some other things that are happening, our church picnic. The date is set for July 31st. and that'll be here before you know it. So we're going to have a wonderful event there, and I hear there's roasted chicken involved, so you definitely do not want to miss that. And that's the 31st of July. Also, on the 1st of July, that's this Friday, the Strongsville Community Band will be having another concert. And from what I hear, the people who did the garage sale and then went to his concert on Friday were very happy. They had a great time. Mike had a solo then, and I'm sure that this Friday's concert will be just as wonderful. It's free. Is it free?
It's free.
It's free. So.
It's patriotic.
Ooh, perfect for the 4th of July weekend.
Same time, same place.
Same time, same place. It's in the bulletin. Let's see. Sunday school, they will be having a special lesson upstairs with Mrs. Elkins. I hear there's paint involved in that. Is that true, Mrs. Elkins? Okay, so while the kids are up there painting, we can be packing. Good?
No, it's...
Oh, it's you'll be done by then so they can help pack with painty fingers? I love it. I also would like to welcome Tom Foley back from his sojourn to Disney World. He's back in action. His mom Carol is better, and we are expecting her next week. And also some special guests today. If many of you might remember Paul and Millie Lancer, who were members here for a long time, some time ago. Well, their daughters are here, so we'd like to welcome them to their home church. Does anyone else have any announcements? Oh, Linda E.
Just that there's no Sunday school next week.
Next week, kids will get a hiatus from their Sunday school classes, and they may remain in worship with us on the 3rd of July. And Judy B.
Reverend Thomas's son and daughter-in-law are here with us also.
Yes, welcome, welcome. They're sitting next to Leland Uwe,
son and daughter-in-law. I'd like to introduce our son.
Yes.
Anil Umben, and his lovely wife, Pastor Reverend Melanie Umben. And I want them to introduce themselves because that's a good reason, so you would understand them.
We are so happy that you're here worshiping with us.
So I'm Anil Umben, and I'm a professor at a university in Oregon. And then my wife is, she just got a new position with the UCC national offices here in Cleveland. So we're here. She's here this week for some work.
Congratulations and welcome. So Reverend Thomas's son, Anil Uman, he is here. He's a professor in Oregon. And his wife just got a position with the national office of the UCC, which is based in Cleveland. So welcome and thank you for being here. Lydia, say is yours for prayers and concerns? Because we've got to get the service done. Is that okay? All right. Let's begin our worship.
Thank you.
Wait till we get to Joyce Concert. Wait till we get to Joyce Concert.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able for the call to worship. With the faithful as well as the foolish, with the voiceless and those who talk too much.
We gather to praise our God.
With those who find it easy to follow, with those who stumble along the way.
We rejoice in Jesus, who makes us whole and calls us sisters and brothers.
With all who are heirs to the promises of grace, with all who share hope with others.
We give thanks to the Spirit of Peace, who cradles us in the arms of hope.
Please join us in singing the hymn printed in your bulletin, Open the Eyes of My Heart. Have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. Keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure. Because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful 1C to K. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Elaine. Thank you, Kent. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Sharon. Thank you. You're here, and that is all that matters. We are here together to praise God and worship. As we go to the sharing of joys and concerns, if you have not already heard, it is with great sadness that I share that our friend Robert Craig passed away on Wednesday. There is nothing more to say. He sat right there, and he always had a smile. He was my friend who would say, I want to get rid of all my money before I die. I want my last check to bounce. I just hope I didn't make it out to you. So we don't have information yet about a memorial, but there will be one as the family comes together and decides what to do. So please keep Susan and Robert's nieces. Susan is Robert's late wife's cousin. And she's a delightful woman and appreciates our prayers. So please pray for the family. What other joys and concerns do we bring, Lynn?
A concern for my husband that he has a successful operation, and for the role this is a great decision that it doesn't cause too much trouble in this country.
Yeah, prayers for Reggie as he has his surgery, and prayers for the nation as we negotiate new territory in a post-Roe society. Linda?
Just a question. You mentioned that about donation, and I read this, and it says that last week we received $11,000. That's a lot of money, and I just wonder, should we be thanking some one person for that, or do you want to?
If that person wishes to be thanked, thank you. If you choose to remain anonymous, as many donors like that do, thank you anyway. Yeah. And thank you, Linda. Christopher.
I have a joy and a concern. A concern for one of my sisters, Tabby, because she has recently lost a friend, from death. And a joy for my other sister, Anna, because she went to the college that she wanted to go to, and not the college that she wanted to go to just because of my sister.
Okay, so one sister, a concern that lost a friend who died. The other sister got into the college she wants to go to. Thank you, Chris. Serena.
With the recent shootings in Parma lately and with the Roe versus Wade outcome, prayers for the safety of everybody that will be in Lakewood, including Isabella and Annalise, protesting the overturn.
There will be marches and protests everywhere today and in the coming days. Pray for peace in the heart that manifests in communities. Thank you. Bonnie, welcome back.
Still continued prayers for my brother. He's in a really, really dark place.
Continued prayers for Matthew, correct? Yeah, thank you. Mary.
On the political side, enjoy that the two political parties came together to pass a bill or some legislation this week that many people consider important to keep weapons of war out of the hands of angry 18-year-olds.
Yes, that the two parties did manage to come together and pass something resembling a bill to curtail some of the gun violence. Yeah, that bipartisanship is a good thing. Yeah. Sharon, welcome back. Prayers of thanksgiving for all your support while Sharon has been negotiating new paths of health. Linda.
I want to thank all the people who donated their talents in the baking field for their donations to the bake sale, and that will benefit our Sunday school. Thank you all who came together and helped us.
Yes, the many hands who made many things, many delicious things for the bake sale to benefit the Sunday school. Yeah, Ingrid.
Prayer
Chris, so Bruce Keenan had some surgery on Friday, and so far so good. So thank you for that.
Bruce Keenan is recovering from some surgery. So far so good. One day at a time. Thank you.
I wanted to thank the prayer chain with our prayers. I went to visit Derek's mom who had a stroke at Southwest yesterday. She is doing so much better. Thank you, prayer chain.
Good. Derek's mom who is doing so much better following a stroke. Thank you. Peter.
Joy and concern. First, the joy. It was a joy to have Reverend Thomas lead us in worship last week.
Yes, Peter, let me know that I better watch my back. And your concern?
The news cycle has changed, and we no longer get hour-to-hour updates as to what's going on in Ukraine. But the war, the murders, the atrocities continue. I learned after I was in church last week that it was National Refugee Day. So I Googled, and I found out that 12 million people have been displaced in Ukraine, and that 5 million people have left the country, leaving 7 million homeless. So let us pray for the refugees.
Yes, that's kind of, as you say, it's left the news cycle. One thing replaces another. And the refugees out of Ukraine, massive numbers, just millions who are displaced from their homes and then displaced from their nation, where they have always been welcomed and loved and comfortable, and now not anymore. Yes, thank you. Lydia, keep it short, please.
It feels like I want to say that this church has Holy Spirit, but not everyone church has, because I know in the middle parts the church don't have Holy Spirit. But we have the question what kind of spirit they have. I have God's message. God is coming. Ukraine war, it is in this life. It is war for Russia and Ukraine. And spiritual, it is war between God and evil. Evil covered mostly, more than half of the world. Last he did COVID, took too many innocent people. Then he made monster Putin, and evil was collected. Now, my monster Putin brought to kill people, Ukrainian, Polish, the covered the whole world. It was evil plan. God wanted to stop. By Ukrainian people, dying for us. Ukrainian people dying to save our world. Why Ukrainian people? Because Ukrainian people, I know, I was in Russia, but I was Ukraine. I know here Ukraine. They more spiritual. They more brave. They more stronger. God is there now. Every child who is dying now in Ukraine is a holy angel. Every person who is have Holy Spirit from mother's womb, going to angel. Other people who don't have Holy Spirit, God blessing them, they go to heaven. They know that they die. God forces sacrifice because there is no other way to save our world. I like this church. Last time I heard this from you, not just from me, from these people they have to. Today you said again, you said, open my eyes, open my heart. People have to come to church. Listen to me. You, because you say open my eyes. I know that God talking here is my Holy Spirit. This is flower, symbol of prayer. This God told me this is flower. It's the holy flower, flower of Holy Spirit, flower of angels. It is Ukraine, you'll be holy land. Уже when God will. Too many people go. Right now, my mission. Why I suffer? You remember I said to you last time from, I know.
Yes.
And now, my mission to find people to Holy Spirit. Some people now doing, oh, Jesus Christ, time. He will not come to work like before. He already, you remember what he said? I know before you born, I choose you to my mother's womb. I give you Holy Spirit. And right now, these people I found these people 2 years, 1 year, 15, 16, 60, they are spiritually very high. They are ready to see people. I want to say this is now I give two messages from God to Heidi. It is so miracle. God said, go there, buy this, do this, go to this mission person. I just wonder. What he said today was, oh, it is not just luck. You know what I want to say is this? Now, God is coming. Because Lord, we are finished. God, no more. Now, we have to everyone, listen our heart, we said.
A good reminder that God is always, always working in big ways and in small. And in each one of us, God's Spirit is moving us and carrying us forward, always for the good of the kingdom. Thank you. Let's pray together. Holy God, in these times of trouble, help us to remember that in your beautiful vision, today is like every other day. Still you are strong in our midst. Still you are offering us the peace and the comfort and the healing. Still you are all in all. And for this we are truly grateful. Lord, in this moment of silence, we offer before you the prayers that are simply too difficult to speak out loud. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and we shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. One heart, one mind, one family at a time. Lord, let us lift our hearts and pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, it's interesting, Ken, that you were playing the Native American flute earlier. Yesterday, in 1876, was when bad things happened to Colonel Custer at the Little Bighorn. So this weekend has been a commemoration of that event in our history. Here come children! There they are! And there's more! Always more. I am going to need a panel of adult experts to help this morning. It's not hard. But if you would be willing to be an expert, be thinking about that. You're terrified, aren't you? I can tell. Good morning. It is so good to see you. I saw a lot of you yesterday. You too, you've had a big week. They were off at camp, but they made it back safely. That's good. I'm glad you had a good time. So this morning with the adults, we're going to talk about fruit of the Spirit. Now, what's fruit? Tell me some fruits.
Strawberry.
Strawberry, Riley.
Mango.
Apples.
Watermelon.
Yeah, good one. Ella? Cherries. Bananas. Yeah, there are lots of different kinds of fruits. And when we talk about fruit of the Spirit, that means ways that we see God working, and it shows in our lives. So in the Bible, there is a list of 9 fruit of the Spirit. And so that's where our panel of experts come in. If you can't tell me what you think one of the fruit is or means or how you could show it, we'll call on somebody out there to help. So, the first fruit of the Spirit is love. What is love, and how do you show someone you love them? You can give them a hug. That's a great way. Yeah. And the other way? A kiss. Maybe a sandwich. If you're looking hungry and I give you a sandwich, that might be because I love you, huh? Okay. Or buying something for them. Yeah, you do good with love. Okay, what about joy? What does joy mean? You're happy. You're super happy. Yeah. What do you do when you feel joy?
I smile.
You smile? Yeah. Yeah. You get excited. All those things. Okay, love, joy. Then comes peace. What does peace mean?
Quiet.
Quiet is good. Lacey?
If you miss your mom, you could be sad.
Yeah, if you miss your mom, you were happy, but that could make you sad. But then you can feel peace when mom comes back. Love, joy, peace. Next comes patience. Right? Waiting. Perfect. What else, Jack? A long line at the Iron Dragon at Cedar Point that Jack waited patiently. And you got a turn, didn't you? Sometimes waiting can be very hard. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. What's kindness, Jack? Yeah, it can mean you're sharing. Ella, what else? Start and your mommy comes? Yeah. I think we need some help with kindness. Would you like to take the microphone, Penny? And who's an expert on kindness? Somebody want to give us an example of kindness? Oh, Sharon has her hand up back there. Thank you, Sharon.
I thought of an example of kindness. When somebody, it happened yesterday to me. I was at a coffee shop real quick, and they were needed to get into the coffee shop, and they were handicapped, and they were in a wheelchair. Opened the door for them, and they were able to get in.
Yes, that's a good example of kindness. Thank you. Okay, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness. What's an example of goodness, Ella? You want to go find an adult to help you? Okay. Here, go over here to Lynn.
The other day I went to Walmart, and as I was leaving, is this on?
Yeah.
As I was leaving, I saw a woman that was in the sun, and she had all her things around her, and I didn't have a lot on me, so I bought three tomatoes, so I said, as I was leaving, I said, do you want a tomato so she could eat later? And she said, thank you. And I wanted to give her more, but I couldn't because
that's great. Yeah. Kindness in sharing when you don't necessarily have a lot is goodness. It's back now. Yeah, goodness. Lacey, you want to love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. You want to go find an expert. You don't get to choose your mom. Who's an expert? Faithfulness. Who's an expert on faithfulness?
Right here.
Go to Serena.
Faithfulness would be, no matter how hard times get, no matter how low you get, you never let your faith waver in God, and you trust in Him to help you get through anything and every challenge that you face.
All right. Very nice. Thank you. Okay. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Let's see. Jack? You want to go find somebody that can tell us about gentleness? Let's walk back this way and see who we can ask. Diana, how about you? Gentleness.
Gentleness can be
what?
Gentleness can be when you are picking up a puppy and you're very careful so they don't get hurt, or a baby, or a friend, or an adult, and you're careful with them so they don't get hurt.
Very nice. Okay. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. There's one more.
What?
Self-control. Oliver. Go find somebody to help us understand self-control. Mary.
Self-control is when there's a lot of good cookies in front of you and you eat just one.
Their opinions. So when you have God's Holy Spirit working in your life, people know by the way you act. Let's pray. Gracious God, help us to want to have more love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, especially around cookies. Amen. Thank you. My faithful assistant doesn't want to leave. My goodness. Oh, it is so good to have everybody this morning. And, Linda made the observation about the sizable contribution we received last week. We get those periodically, and it's amazing, just out of the blue. And we are so grateful because surprises are always good, or almost always good. We appreciate, though, just as much, we appreciate the people that are here every Sunday and every Tuesday when their committee meets and every Wednesday when Women's Fellowship meets on the first Wednesday, and the people who come for our support groups on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, the people who are part of our congregation every single day with their support, their faithfulness, and with their whole lives, really. This is how Christ's kingdom grows, and this is how we thrive as a congregation and as Christ's kingdom in the world. I am ever so grateful for you this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
that boulders and tiny stones together build your kingdom. Help us, Lord, to use these gifts faithfully in service to you. Amen. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations you have placed upon each of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your eye, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Many moons ago, my first year teaching four-year-olds, we had a little boy named John. John's dad was a single father, and he was doing his best, but John was a big boy, and sometimes it seemed as if his arms and legs had a mind of their own. John was the little boy who, if we gave an instruction like, "Don't touch that," John would hear every word, except "don't," and he would promptly reach out to touch whatever it was. One time, near the end of the day, we were making this wonderful substance called Glorp. It's made from Elmer's glue and borax. It's wonderful. It's stretchy and it's cool and it's very sticky if it gets in your hair. Aww. One of the little girls was stretching her little ball of Glorp and holding it way up high, "Teacher, teacher," and it was getting dangerously close to her beautiful blonde hair. "Oops, oops, be careful, don't let the Glorp go in your hair." Immediately I turn around and there's John holding the Glorp directly over his head and feeling it drip onto his scalp. I watched as it landed right on top of his head. Dad was very understanding, and the next day, John had a buzz cut. That was who John was. So at the end of the school year, we had planned a field trip to the zoo, and we asked several parents to come along with our 14 students to even the odds a little bit. As we packed up lunches and got ready to go, John's dad took me aside and handed me a small backpack. "Here," he said, "you're going to want this. It's John's leash." I tried not to roll my eyes and assured him we wouldn't need it, but he insisted, so I slung the backpack over my shoulder. We all boarded the bus and headed off for a beautiful day at the Metro Park Zoo. When we arrived, there were already other groups of children, classes of all ages, milling around and buzzing. We divvied up the class, assigning children to the helping parents, and I took John's hand as we got off the bus, and we went through the gate. There was so much to see at the zoo, so many tempting distractions besides the animals. We started over towards the elephants. We had taken about 10 steps when John pulled up short, clutching my hand tightly, looking at me, pleading with his eyes, "Mrs. Denman, can I please have my leash?" I looked at him. "Please, I want my leash. It makes me feel safer." I looked at the other teacher and she gave me that, "Well, whatever you think is best" look, and she smiled. So I looked at John again, and he was clearly growing more agitated by the moment. "Well, okay, buddy, here, hold out your arms. Let's get this on. Here we go." I slipped the harness across his chest, hooked up the leash, and immediately he began to breathe more naturally. What a difference. As we walked through the zoo together, a handful of mothers gave us the look. One even said something about how she would never put a child on a leash. I looked her in the eye and I said, "You know what? Every child is different. He asked to have his leash. It makes him feel safer." You see, what John realized was that his leash gave him both freedom and limits. He could let go of my hand, but he was still only allowed to go about 5 feet away. And he was okay with that. We had a terrific day together, and we all went home exhausted, but happy. Freedom and limits. It can be a tough road to hoe. We want to believe there are one-size-fits-all rules in life, but that is seldom the case. In today's passage from Paul's letter to the church at Galatia, Paul has left Galatia and moved on. But another group of religious leaders moved in, and they started teaching that before you could become a follower of Jesus, you first had to become a Jew and follow every rule set down by Jewish leaders. Specifically, in this case, the leaders were insisting that all men must be circumcised and everyone must follow the strict dietary laws set forth in Deuteronomy. In his letter, Paul's task is to gently yet forcefully correct their thinking, helping them see that Christianity was not about checking off a whole bunch of requirements. It was about learning to walk in the way of the Christ. So listen to part of the passage, and it's from Galatians 5, not 3 like it says in your bulletin. My fault, not Irene's. And I'll be reading from the New International Version. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. If you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. The entirety of Jewish law, all 600 plus rules and regulations, is summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. How many times in Scripture have we heard Jesus himself say those very words? Paul then goes on to clarify what this really means. When Paul writes of the flesh, he is referring to more than just our human body. He's referring to what he perceived as the sinful state of humanity, brought about by a power or darkness that makes us do things that we often know are not helpful or good for anyone but ourselves, but we do them anyway. Behaving this way grieves God's Holy Spirit. We should work hard not to do that. Indeed, that's what these outside leaders were trying to do when they came in and laid down all these laws for these new baby Christ followers to adhere to. Paul is telling them flat out, you have got it all wrong. In Eugene Peterson's The Message, Paul's words sound like this: it is obvious what kind of life develops out of trying to get your own way all the time. Repetitive, loveless, cheap sex, a stinking accumulation of mental and emotional garbage, frenzied and joyless grabs for happiness, trinket gods, magic show religion, paranoid loneliness, cutthroat competition, all consuming yet never satisfied wants, a brutal temper, an impotence to love or be loved, divided homes, divided lives, small-minded and lopsided pursuits, the vicious habit of depersonalizing everyone into a rival, uncontrolled and uncontrollable addictions, ugly parodies of community. I could go on and on. If you use your freedom this way, you will not inherit God's kingdom. Well, gosh, Paul and Reverend Peterson, tell us how you really feel. This sounds pretty familiar, though, doesn't it? That's a pretty sharp stick when you get poked with it. But if we're honest, many of our behaviors are driven not by the law of love, but by love of ourselves, usually at the expense of another's well-being. It's so much easier, for instance, to simply take something away from someone else rather than put in the hard work to earn it for ourselves. Children learn that at a very young age, and if not constantly corrected, consistently redirected by the adults in their lives, will continue to bully their way through life. Such behavior, Paul would argue, is decidedly un-Christ-like. I would agree. So what does Paul offer instead? A beautiful list of what he labels fruit of the Spirit, and you've heard it many times already this morning. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. In other words, when we allow God's Spirit to direct us, our lives will bear fruit that is worthy of the vine that bears us. Treating one another with loving kindness, feeding the birds, offering to others the peace we experience in our own souls, taking a deep breath and smiling instead of scolding, and offering caring and support through crisis, all these are the fruit, singular, of the Spirit in our lives. In fact, the only way we will ever be able to truly love others as we are loved is with God's help. We have a hard enough time loving people we care about, let alone being kind and generous to people whom we don't really care much about or want to be around. I mean, seriously, you know, if everyone would only think like me, act like me, dress like me, and love like me, there'd be no more problems in the world, right? Oh, that it were that simple. Because like so darned many things in life, it just isn't that cut and dried. We have seen many examples of that in this past week. If I am truly loving of my neighbor, that has to include being able to trust them to make their own decisions and choices. With children like John and the Glorp, telling a child not to do something, making the rules too tight and the leash too short, is likely to accomplish exactly the opposite of what we desire. Children, especially teenagers, have a desire to push the envelope. It is always safer in the long run to help others determine what the right thing is for them to do in their situation rather than try to make rules that apply to everyone. We cannot always know the reasons behind another's choices, and often it's none of our business anyway. Our task always is to love as we have been loved by Jesus. When the woman in Luke's gospel who had been bleeding for over 12 years reached out and touched Jesus' robes, did he address her? Yes, he did. Not to judge, but with an invitation to come forward and be fully healed by love. With the centurion's younger daughter, when she was ill and the centurion asked Jesus to offer her care, did Jesus decline? No. He accompanied the centurion, not a Jew, to his home, and he made the situation better, not worse. He didn't judge, he didn't scold or belittle. He simply offered love. This, friends, is our task in every situation. Now, as I am certain you are aware, a very big decision came down from the Supreme Court of the United States on Friday that effectively reversed the settled law allowing women to make their own safe, informed decisions about reproductive health care. In pastoral circles, the conversation has been, shall we say, lively? We have been weeping together, raging together. Some are celebrating. But ultimately, we realize that what matters most and what always will is how we can continue to share the love of Jesus and emulate his behavior in our complicated modern world. This morning, I want to tell you personally what I believe my role is as a pastor and follower of Christ. I trust you, I do. And I trust that whatever you believe is the best decision for you alone in your unique situation, and that is up to you. My job is to continue to love you as Jesus loves, as best as I am able, to help you in whatever way is necessary, and to affirm and assure that you are safe. I stand with the minority decision over Roe v. Wade. Do I wish abortions didn't happen? You bet I do. But there will always be women who see no other way out. Therefore, in my opinion, abortion needs to remain safe and medically available when necessary. Do I expect everyone to agree with me? Do I look that naive? Because I really do try to love and respect all of God's children. I accept that we can see things differently and still remain close in the family of God. For this, I am truly grateful, because I cannot imagine not having every single one of you here with me on Sunday to worship and pray together. I know I got political. These are issues of justice, of human rights, of women's rights. And Christ stood for all those things and still does. So one more time, here's that beautiful list from Paul's letter. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Let us stand together and sing, hopefully and with one voice, I have decided to follow Jesus, number 602.
For the third verse, where it says, though none go with me, us musicians are going to cut out, and it's just going to be the voices for that third verse. So sing with power.
Thank you.
bumpy road. Christ on his way to Jerusalem and the cross. One day the crowds were cheering, the next they were throwing stones. So it is with each of our journeys. We may feel humanly alone, but God's Spirit is always, always in our midst. So as we go out into the world, let the fruit of the Spirit blossom, mature, and ripen in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these. Let us cultivate them. In the name of Jesus, we ask that you perfect us, whatever that may take, and give us the grace to endure that renovation process. Go now in peace. Amen.